I dream of these people every night. The only thing I worry about is that some total unknown that nobody ever heard of comes along.
Let's give it up again for the future First Lady, my wife, Evelyn Yang. Evelyn. I certainly married up. It's very, very clear. So I think we're going to take some questions from some of the Iowans who joined us on this tour. Is that right, Heidi?
Our first question is going to be from Army veteran Greg Honig.
Well, the first question on behalf of my family and also on behalf of the Yang Gang is actually for Evelyn.
Here you go, baby.
As the future First Lady, what causes would you look to champion?
So there are a number of causes I would champion, but the first one that is so close to our family, and you heard Andrew talk about it tonight, is advocating for families with special needs children. I think we are possibly the first family running for president to publicly embrace the fact that we are a special needs family. And there are so many millions of special needs families out there. We know what it's like to get a diagnosis of autism and having to plan that road ahead. And it's not easy. And we're lucky because we have the resources to give our son what he needs to continue to make progress. But unfortunately, there are families all across this country, many right here in Iowa, that have access to practically nothing. And that's just unimaginable and wrong. So as First Lady, I would make it one of my priorities to advocate for them to make sure that their children have access to the resources and options to make sure that they can thrive and have every shot at success.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Allison. I met you last night. It's nice to see you again. So in rural Iowa, women of childbearing age don't have access to contraception, whether it be free or otherwise. These women reside in a women's healthcare and contraception deserts where there is no OBGYN or women's healthcare provider for hundreds of miles. I'm interested in knowing how you would help to make contraception, but especially long-acting reversible contraception, more accessible for even better, free for every woman of the United States, regardless of insurance coverage or reimbursements.
Thank you for your leadership and activism on this. Women's reproductive rights are fundamental human rights, and we have to fight for them at every stage. My initial response to this was, as a man, I should just leave the room and let women decide for themselves what they're going to do. I have a feeling.
We don't get pregnant on our own, though.
No. But then a woman very wisely said, hey, I appreciate the spirit of that, but you have to actually champion access to women's reproductive rights at every level. And I said, oh, you're right. Once again, like a woman turned me in the right direction. So we need to make sure that women have access to contraceptives at every stage. Certainly having some additional economic resources in people's hands will help that a great deal, because we know right now a lot of this is about economic freedom. But then we have to invest in Planned Parenthood and clinics to make sure that these services are accessible. I can't believe that there are certain states in this country that are actually rolling back those rights. I will protect those rights at the federal level. I will codify Roe v. Wade. And I will appoint Supreme Court justices who will agree with the truth that women's reproductive rights are human rights. And I will make sure that we have access to women's reproductive services in every community that we can reach. One of the things I've said is that if men became pregnant instead of women, this would be a very, very different conversation. You know what I mean? Like you kind of imagine what access to contraception would look like then. That's actually a vision I would endorse.
Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Alex Iannone, and my question is for Andrew tonight. And my question comes actually from my husband, who knows you as the UBI candidate. So my question is, with a large field of Democratic candidates, what other than UBI sets you apart from the crowd?
Is your husband not here?
No.
That's fine. That's all good. I think what sets me apart from the other candidates is that I see the true nature of the problems that are making us miserable. The fact that our health care and housing and education costs keep on climbing while our wages stay the same. The fact that technology is transforming not just our work opportunities, but also impacting our mental health, making our kids more anxious and depressed. And the tough truth is that it's very difficult to address the problems that technology is causing if you don't understand technology. And there are a number of people in the field that, through no fault of their own, don't truly understand the impact of technology in the 21st century economy and on our families and on the way our brains are even wired. I think one of the paramount threats to our national security is China leapfrogging us in artificial intelligence, because I've sat with the foremost technologists in our country and they're deeply concerned that we're not gonna be able to keep up because this is an aside. Did you know that more Chinese watched artificial intelligence beat the best human player in a game of Go than watched the Super Bowl in the United States that year? So that's how focused they are on this technology that represents the frontier. And I am determined to make sure that America actually solves the real problems that are facing us and stays globally competitive in a way that I don't believe the other candidates can.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Callie. And I'm actually one of those families that has a special needs child. And I would like to know, Evelyn, what you would recommend to the schools to help them better help our children.
Hi, Kelly. Thank you for that question. Education is so important for all our children, not just our kids with special needs. And what I would want to do is move education to the 21st century, because right now I feel like so much of education is this cookie cutter, one size fits all model that doesn't serve the needs of most of our children, not just the ones with special needs. There are all sorts of learning profiles and learning differences, and whether you have a diagnosis or not, our children are being left behind by this archaic model. And what we need to do is empower our teachers and educators to have the tools to have abilities to be more flexible in the classroom. So being able to personalize learning and teach to the individual, possibly scaling down class sizes when they need to, almost like a modular kind of, that would be my vision for education, is just, and leveraging technology when we can. There's so much that we can do to reach individual children and not think of them as like, this is a one-size-fits-all solution. And the other thing I would do is integrate social emotional learning at every level. It's so critical that they learn the stuff of life instead of being so focused on standardized tests. Yeah.
Thank you.
Our little boys definitely need some of those lessons.
Hi, I'm Sabrina.
Katrina, and I wanted to ask Andrew how he would attack the climate crisis through the eyes of a parent.
Hey, Sabrina, how are you? How many of you think climate change is an existential threat to our way of life? I agree. We have to make progress as quickly as possible. If you saw a few debates ago, you remember me staking out the new third position in American politics on climate change? You remember this? Position number one, we have to fight climate change. Position number two, climate change is a hoax. And then Andrew Yang's position number three, it's worse than you think. We are 20 years behind on fighting climate change, and you all have experienced it with the floods that ravaged many communities here in Iowa. In California, it's the forest fires. In New Hampshire, it's the shrimping business going from millions of dollars to zero. Climate change is already here. The last 4 years have been the four warmest years in recorded history. So the question is, how do we make progress so that we actually can look at Christopher and Damien and say that the planet's going to be in great shape for them? The first thing we have to do is put a price on pollution. Because right now, when someone pollutes, we pay for it and they don't. We have to make sure that the firms themselves pay a price for every carbon emission, every time they do anything that despoils our environment. If they internalize the cost, shocker, they're going to start becoming much more judicious and efficient about it. Then we take those resources and invest in wind and solar and renewable sources of energy and try and take all the fossil fuel subsidies that are way past their sell-by date and then move them over to more sustainable forms of energy. Now, the tough truth in all this is that the United States of America is only 15% of global emissions. So even if we were to get ourselves under control and the other 85% goes up, climate change still continues to get worse. And what's happening in the rest of the world is that China is going to Africa and saying, hey, we've got a power plant for you, it burns coal. And then what does the African government say? Great, we just want energy. So if you wanted to stop emissions from rising, you would need to be at the table with the African government and say, hey, don't take the coal-burning power plant. Here are some solar panels, and we're going to subsidize them and make it a no-brainer for you. That is the kind of effort we need to lead as quickly as possible, while acknowledging that we need to invest in making our communities more resilient right now. When there's a natural disaster, who suffers the most? Poor people who don't have strong shelters or cars they can drive away in. So putting money into our hands will lift the least among us, but then we have to invest billions of dollars in making our communities more resilient. It's more expensive to clean up a disaster than it is to build the levees ahead of time. I am the only candidate in the field that is advocating a constitutional amendment so that the government will be tied to preserving our environment through the generations. And I think a lot of the reason why we can't make progress on climate change is that 78% of us are living paycheck to paycheck. Almost half of us can't afford an unexpected $500 bill. So when someone comes to them and says, we need to worry about climate change, what do they say? I can't pay my bills. I'm worried about next month, let alone something that's 5 to 10 years away. And then what's a human reaction if that's the way you feel? It's probably not that big a deal anyway. It's probably going to be okay. And when you talk to many Americans about fighting climate change, unfortunately, what they hear is higher prices, greater inconvenience, and fewer jobs. This mindset of scarcity that's tearing us apart is keeping us from making real progress on climate change, because so many people have this boot on their throat. So if we put $1,000 a month into their hands and they can look at their kids and say, we're going to be here for a while, and then you come back and say, we need to fight climate change, they're much more likely to say, yes, yes, we do. And then if you integrate environmental sustainability with our economic measurements, you can get rid of this tug of war where people think, oh, it's bad for jobs, it's bad for the economy if you fight climate change. If you had to put a dollar price tag on the impact of climate change, how much would it be? trillions of dollars, and unfortunately thousands and thousands of American lives. When you include the cost of not doing anything, you realize that that's the most expensive course of action of all. So what we have again is a measurement problem where if you line up environmental sustainability as a measurement of economic progress, we can see that going green actually is good for the economy because it's going to make us stronger and healthier.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sabrina. Yeah.
Can we get a big round of applause for our future president and first lady? So we've got some big news because the media is finally paying attention to us. We're about to go live on CNN. So we're going to ask Andrew and Evelyn to head down with Lacey, and we invite you to join him. We're going to have this section right here in the front, and if you'd like to crowd around that section to show the support to the nationwide, that'd be awesome. Thank you so much, everybody.
And then if you stick around, very happy to say hello, take selfies with each and every...
Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang. Yeah, yeah. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang.